Q&A. I told you a bunch of stuff. Any questions you want for me or Jackie, but please. Yes, ma'am.
So we know that you failed at retirement.
Right,
so
right.
We established that. But how do you do so many things and have so much breadth, but put any depth into what you're doing? Yeah. Like, how do you manage that?
So one of the things I said is I get up early. So there's a book, Let the Trumpet Sound. And it's a biography of Martin Luther King by a guy named Stephen Oates. It's one of the most seminal books that I ever read. And it talked about how MLK got up at 5 in the morning and worked till about 10. And he said, everything I accomplished after that was extra gravy. So I get up early and I write. You'd be surprised, 24 hours is a long time. But if you're watching TV and on the phone and doing your day job and you know, whatever else you got to do, and then the weekend, then the club and all this stuff, it's like it's how we use our time that really determines what our output is. And so I just decided to pour into productive stuff. Because remember what I told you about my college days. So I was still spending hours at school. But I wasn't reading, I wasn't going to class. So they weren't the most productive hours if I was going to do school. When I rearranged that, I remember that my first honors course, by that time I had a 2.5, and the professor said, you're doing really good, and I want you to take this honors course. So I had learned to read the rules. And the rule was, you had to have a 3.0 or better to take the honors, the AP class. And so I recited that. He was like, yeah, but the other part of the rule is, or be invited by the professor. I'm inviting you. So the honors class was 2 hours of class, 3 hours of credit, and you got to pick your own book. And I'm like, damn, I can make A in this class, pick my own books, get extra credit. And so I learned that the rules were my friends. And so now, most things I do, I read the policy, the rules, etc., and it makes a difference, but it's how you spend that time. Productive time. And so for me, the other important thing is, and the other key to success, I kind of cheated. I told you the important thing for individuals was putting your you-know-what on the line. Let me show you that again. But the important thing for a company is everybody working together. When we work together as human beings, we're pretty unstoppable. So the other thing was having people. When I first started at Verizon, I used to run the phone company here. When I left, we had $4.5 billion in revenue. I had about 10,000 people working for me. When I started at Verizon, I came in, and it was October. And I said, hey, BK, it was like 2 days in. We want your accomplishments for the year. For the year. And I thought of myself, I went to the bathroom, literally. I'm like, oh man, you know. Yeah. And I was like, wait a minute. I got people. I got a team. I'm not in this by myself. So I got myself together. Went out, Andy, that's my EA. Call a meeting. In my office in 10 minutes. Everybody comes to the office. Hey, Mr. Well, you know, we've had a good year. We need to produce a report on our accomplishments. Chris, you're in charge. You've been here the longest, and you're the senior person on the team. How long do you all need to produce a report? A couple days. Take the rest of the week and give me a report on Monday. Now, mine was due on Wednesday. So I gave them the time. I gave myself a little bit of time because I had to fix something or make some stuff up. And don't do that. Authenticity is important. And we put it together, and it was smooth sailing from then on. Because when you got people, you don't have to do everything. That was the other big thing for me to learn. Because when I started out in the nonprofit world, shifted to government, and my first couple of jobs in corporate, I felt like everything was on me. When I learned that I could get help, that made the work easier, the outcome better, and nobody had to kind of fall on the sword. So pick and choose, get a team if you need it, You've got great leadership. There's a lot of talent here. You are the leaders of the company. And, you know, you pull together and everybody wins. On my team, I told them, look, guys, it's not about just one of us looking good. We win or lose together. We're not going to let anybody fall on their face. So one important thing, you touch it, you own it. Don't walk by and see somebody's stuff messed up, and you keep on walking, man. They're gonna be crazy when they see that old raggedy stuff coming up in here. No. You do realize you left out this data point, and that could make a difference in your presentation. Help each other. That gets contagious. Then all of a sudden, everybody is lifting everybody, and the whole platform rises. And then you take the company to another level. And when the company does good, everybody does good. All right. Any other questions? Don't be shy.
I got
one.
Yes, please. All right. So, you've done a lot of work through different mediums. You've created poems, song, books, and in some of that, there's a version of storytelling that's coming out, and that's a common theme that we've brought up here in our meetings, and it's a big part of. I think how we're shaping our branding and who we are as a company. Two-part question. What do you look for in finding a really good story to tell? And my second part of that is, in those elements, does that translate into your business decisions as well?
Okay. So first one's easy. The second one takes a little bit more time. What I tend to look for in a good story is authenticity, because the real stories are the things that I think shape our lives. And there are many different things that can shape our lives. And so authenticity is very critical. How does it translate into business? Well, we live in the real world. And so when I was at America Online working for Steve Case, the chairman, and then they said, we were going to do this big deal and buy this company called Time Warner. And it was a huge, biggest deal of its kind at the time. And did the deal, 9/11 happened. Because people thought it was going to be so much of a success, the biggest media company and the biggest online company, so we were going to have all these advantages, that the policymakers curtailed our ability to leverage Time Warner Cable, to leverage the content. We had to sell it to others. And so what ended up happening was it became a big failure, actually. You know, but if folk would have been, I think, more honest, more authentic about the reality of what we had created, I think we wouldn't have accepted some of the policy things that we accepted because we just knew it was going to be this big thing. In our dreams, it was going to be this big thing. But in reality, no one knew. And so it was unwise of us to say, we won't sell the new content until we let somebody else wholesale. That's crazy. We didn't look at the culture of Time Warner versus the culture of AOL. AOL was a matrix management company. So basically, whoever you needed on your team, to include Steve, you go, you put it together, you get it done. Time Warner was more these kind of fiefdoms. And you had Time, HBO, Warner Brothers. Each one had their own board, they had their own executives, and they reported up to the holding company, Time Warner. And so they were accountable for their profit and loss. So when AOL came in with this matrix style, hey, everybody work together, give me the content, let me get some Superman, let me get some Time magazine, we're gonna throw this out here in a new portal and make a gazillion dollars. The head of Marvel was like, how much you gonna pay me? Hey, we own you. How much you gonna pay me? Time, how much you gonna pay me? And they were charged, and it wasn't exclusive. So all this rule that was set up, you got to switch, you own all this content. The culture clashed. So there wasn't this authentic assessment of what the assets were and how they played together and what the thing would become, because we weren't sure, nobody was sure. And so it actually didn't go the way it was going to go. How did that affect me? One day I'm working with Steve. The next day, you know, Steve puts in his resignation letter. So I'm like, man. So they gave us really nice packages, though, so I ain't mad at them.
You had your golden parachute. Yeah, you did.
But, and then, so I went to government for a little while, and that was, really, talking about authenticity. So I was the COTAR, the Contract Officer's Representative for the .us domain. So anything .us came to me for like a year and a half. And I had to write this memo for the Secretary of Commerce. Real story. That was my first assignment. I wrote the memo. I mean, it took me 10, I'm a lawyer, it took me 10 minutes. Send it up front to the front office. First day at work. The secretary for the secretary walks down to my office, Mr. Fulton. Welcome to the U.S. Department of Commerce. Here is your memo. Don't come in here with that corporate shizzle. You've got 2 weeks. But it don't take 2 weeks. You've got 2 weeks. So I was like, I understand. She walked out, I closed my door, I said a little prayer, I said this job is gonna kill me because it moves too slow. I gotta get out of here. I turned to my computer and I signed up to Netflix. And turned out I bought some stock later, which was a very good purchase. But then in being real with myself, I knew I had to get out of there because that pace was too slow for me. For some people, it's fine. But, you know, it was a political thing. So even there, it's lacking the authenticity of what was required. And so you get very slow decisions out of government or things that don't seem to make sense. That's part of the problem with this mess we're dealing with now, is that folk are against things for political reasons and not reasons that make a lot of sense to most people. And when you, and so I try to kind of deconstruct stuff to make it simple, because I don't think life is that hard. When we wake up, we go to sleep, there's some kind of stuff in the middle, and we all want to have a happy life, we all want our families to be good. You know, we're pretty much the same. And then it's the mess that gets thrown in that makes it more complicated. The more authentic we can be with that stuff, the easier it is to put things in their proper perspective. When you know what's important. So when my wife went to the hospital, my movies, my Netflix series, my AR company took a backseat, and I moved into the hospital with her. Because she is the most important human being in my life. When you're authentic, you can prioritize. You know what matters. When you're real with people, you get real results. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
You seem to be at a wonderful spot.
Man, I'm having fun.
But over the years, I know you probably had a lot of ups and downs.
Yeah.
How did you get through those times?
Of months.
Especially with your wife. And I don't know if I can do it. How did you get through those times of adversity? I mean, we just don't see an answer to
Right, right. So, I'm a person of faith. That helps me. Not everybody is. That helps me. I highly encourage it. I grew up in a family, so one of my cousins was a Tuskegee Airman. He trained about 80% of the pilots. Teddy Pendergrass is a cousin. That's probably where the singing chops come from, that side of the family. At the end of the day, there's a lot of preachers in the family, preachers and teachers. And so what our family would pass down is stuff like, if you're going to worry, don't pray. If you're going to pray, don't worry. And so at some point, whether it's put your you-know-what on the line or what that's really about is faith. And do you believe in the stuff you sell? And I'm not going to do church sharing anymore. I have this alter ego. I don't want to go to hell for this, but I have this person in my head I'm thinking about writing about called the Right Reverend Dr. Cleopas Roundabout Senior. And all these kind of sermons. But anyway, that's another story. Let me get back to your question. Stuff happens in life. So we already know that stuff is going to happen. one of the ways I approach it. So I've got faith. I make sure I do all that I can do. I take the steps that I need to take. And the stuff that's outside of my control, I don't have a choice but to throw that out. Human beings get to choose. That's right, isn't that right? Yeah. The human beings get to choose. And so, and that's kind of what separates us from like some of the other species. Important, squirrels, deer, dogs, etc. But they're not human beings. And so, do you choose to be on the happy side of the line or the sad side of the line? The worry side of the line, or are we going to get through side of the line? And my faith helps me to stay on that I can do it side of the line. And then people say, man, you're just so lucky. Everything always worked out. I say, well, the harder I work, the luckier I get. The more I pray and then act on my prayers. Remember, human beings, all of us, have the ability to turn our dreams and ideas into their tangible equivalents. But you have to have the faith, be willing to do the work, and expect the outcome. Those three things I have learned to be true. So not that God cares about where I park, but right now I'm going to park right outside. We will go to Washington, D.C., New York. You pick the city in rush hour. It's maybe what restaurant you want to go to. Okay? We wanted to go to Florida Avenue Grill one time. We were there for a movie meeting. I was like, okay, we're going to park up front. I just call it up. She's like, it's rush hour. Why do you think it's going to be a park?
Put it out there.
I don't think. I know. Because that's the kind of God I serve. Yes. When you think about it, and I say God doesn't really care about my parking space, he actually does. He cares that we get exactly what we expect out of life. Most of the time, if something falls not quite where we want it to be, you have to ask if we did all that we could do. If the answer to that is yes, then maybe that thing just wasn't meant to be. You know? But more often than not, cars, houses, well, that's easy stuff. This brain surgery, we were uncertain at some point, walking in. It was frightening. But then I had to remember who I am and who she is and the kind of life that we've tried to live and the way we've tried to treat people. And there was no, and if I had the choice to say, okay, man, this is going to be terrible, or man, this is going to come out good, which one are you going to say? It's going to come out good. Speak it into being. Speak it into being. And then start to act accordingly. Because when you act accordingly, when I drove up to that parking spot, it's because I expected it to be there. So either somebody was coming out, or they was going to leave, but I expect, and it just happens a lot. I used to tell my wife, I was like, the craziest thing, people pay for my food. She was like, what are you talking about? I was like, I go to the restaurant. And she said, that's because you're cute and these girls are flirting with you. I don't know. Then one day she was in the car with me and we pull up and like, oh, it's already been paid for. She's like, you weren't kidding. I was like, no, I wasn't. You know, I wasn't. And it's like I feel like I've been able to tap into something that we all can tap into. So that's the higher gear. So when the young lady asked a question about, you know, kind of doing stuff and not being too shallow with it, but doing it so it's successful. When you kind of tap into that higher gear, you realize how powerful human beings are. And then when you think about working together, how much more powerful we are. And that's probably the secret sauce of running a successful business that grows to be a very, you know, a behemoth that's the biggest in the state and one of the biggest in the country is working together. But you can't do that part by yourself. There's just so much time in a day. But if you've got your partners and your teammates working with you, etc., then there's no challenge that you at least can't face. And then when you've got God supporting you and you've got that faith and you hit it with, you know, we're going to win. That's your starting position. One more question, or two, whatever you want to do. Yes, ma'am. I am. Yeah, you can follow. All right. It's Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. All of those. Yeah. And I do it myself. And most of the time, so I'm going to warn you, most of my stuff is positive, it's about love and happiness, little places that my wife and I go. So we play this game, Where in the World Are BK and Jay, when we're traveling. And our friends have so much fun trying to figure out where we are. Honey, how many international trips did we do last year? I don't know. At least four, like somewhere between 4 and 7. We did what? Belize, Cuba, China, Dominican Republic. Yeah, I remember she's 4, that's right on 4, okay. And then we're going Italy, coming up for the movie festival. We're actually going to see the Pope on the 4th. And then on the 10th, we'll screen the movie in Palermo. And we'll do some other stuff. We go to London every year. Oh, I didn't tell you about this. So just for fun, we've partnered with Simon Cowell and Dick Parsons and bought part of the Premier League basketball in London. So tip ball is May 2019. So you're all invited to come over and check out a game of the Premier Professional League basketball in London. And so they asked me, what are your requirements for this? I said, well, first of all, you've got to be a return on my money. Because, you know, I ain't doing this for charity. It's important. You can't do the philanthropic stuff without being profitable. So very important. But I also said I need a seat, 2 seats in the owner's box in perpetuity, and good wine. And so I had them to put that in the contract, you know. You can do that. You can do whatever you want. I mean, that's the nice thing. When you hit this plane, you realize that, you know, life is this kind of fun negotiation, and you get to decide when and where you enter. You get to decide how much you partake. And so when you have your choices, choose wisely. Don't choose excellence. Don't be mediocre. Be excellent. And always say, I'm going to show them who I am. I'm going to show them what I represent. And when you have those kind of high standards, whenever I went to a job, I always excelled at the job. Because I never let the job standard be my standard. I always set my standard higher. Always. And it always made the difference. I always got the head slot. And what happens when you get the head slot? You get to boss people around and you got people. So you're not in there on the toilet trying to figure out how you're going to get the report done. You're going to hold the meeting and assign it. And then work with the people. And I always treated my people. It's important to treat people right. Treat people how you want to be treated. And I had this one secretary, EA, and she messed up probably about almost a quarter million dollars. And so my immediate boss said that I probably should fire her. I had never fired an administrative assistant in all my career. I didn't want to start there. So I had a conversation with her. I said, $250,000? And I was like, had anybody trained you to do the finance part of this job? And she was like, no, I just kind of took it on. I was like, okay, that's our app. I do have to write this up because it's a big amount of money. If we do this again, you got to go. But I'm going to send you to school. And I want you to become the best in the company at doing this piece of the work. We good? She is still there. She's been promoted. She's got her degree. When she changed her standard and made it one of excellence and did what she needed to do to get trained to do the job, she did the job and people started coming to her for help and support. So let me close by saying, put it on the line. You're here today, it's beautiful outside, it's beautiful inside. You got a gift. Do something with it. And working together, you can accomplish anything. Thank you for your time.